Hello and welcome to the channel Love Obstetrics and Gynecology. This video is about the instruments that are required for the dilatation and the curettage process. I'll be taking instruments one by one as they are required for the procedure and tell you how to use them. So first up is cleaning your patient, for which you require is a sponge holding forceps. Sponge holding forceps has a lock at the gripping end and ring shaped loop serrated jaws to hold the sponge, as its name suggests. So these are the rings and they have transverse serrations inside their edges. How to clean? You move from inside to outside from your area of interest, here being vulva and perineum first, followed by the surrounding area, abdomen up to the level of umbilicus and thighs till the level of knee. Hold it correctly. You place the thumb and the ring finger in the finger grips, and index and the middle finger are for supporting the shaft. And then you clean your patient. Before starting with the procedure, it is essential to have a preoperative examination under anesthesia to assess the uterine size, mobility, anteversion, retroversion. The next instrument is a Sims speculum or Sims non-self-retaining posterior vaginal wall retractor. This is double-bladed with blades being at right angle and connected in the middle by the shaft. This is for retracting the posterior wall of vagina. It is available in different sizes, and in the middle we have a trough or groove so that the contents obtained from the procedure can be collected or excess products can be drained through it straight into the bucket. And being non-self-retaining, you require an assistant to hold it just like this from the shaft while you conduct the procedure. Next instrument is a Valsalum. It has two finger grips and a lock and a curved forepart with multiple teeth to catch hold the anterior lip of cervix. So this curved part is quite beneficial, and you need to keep the concave part towards the ceiling or towards the pubic bone so that it can arc over the pubic bone and provide you a better visualization. Now showing you the forepart, it has multiple small teeth to hold firmly the cervix lip of a non-pregnant uterus. In case you are dealing with a pregnant uterus, the cervix lip are soft and the Valsalum teeth can cause trauma to the cervix. In that case, you would require a sponge holding forceps to hold the anterior lip of the cervix, and you use a new sponge holding forceps for this, not the one you used for the cleaning of patient. This is a uterine sound, a thin metallic instrument, and its forepart is bent at an angle to negotiate through the uterocervical angle and is graduated with markings either in centimeter or inches with a 2 mm diameter. This is used to measure the uterocervical length, so you go through the cervical canal all the way up to the fundus till you feel the resistance, and then you take your index finger till the level of external os and you measure the uterocervical length. Also, it helps in confirming the antiverted or retroverted position of uterus and acts as a first dilator. Use only in the gynae procedure, as in obstetric there are high chances of perforation in case you measure a UCL. Moving on to the next, we require to perform the dilatation of cervix, for which I have a Haggar's double-sided dilator. It is a metallic rod that has round, slightly curved with a conical tip, and it has two ends with different sizes. The size is mentioned in the middle of the dilator. The size varies from 3 mm to 18 mm. Basically, the small portion of dilator is only required, this much portion is only required to dilate the cervical canal. So after the introduction of Sims speculum and Valsalum, you have hold the cervix, adequately visualizing the external os through which you have to introduce the dilator and dilate the cervical canal gradually and slowly, beginning from a small size dilator and going towards the bigger one. Now how to hold it? Hold this dilator in a pen shaped fashion with thumb, index and middle finger, while your ring and little finger remain outside the vagina so that you do not cause any perforation. Do not enter your hand hole in the vagina. So supposing the ulnar border of my left hand is the perineum and my little and ring finger of the right hand are going to act as a guard to stop the dilator from going too farther into the uterine cavity, and I do not cause any perforation. Gradually dilate the cervix and move from smaller size to the bigger size dilator. If you are performing an obstetric evacuation, the ovum forceps is required. This is an ovum forceps that do not have a lock, and its forepart is a cup shaped with fenestration. A more closer look, see the cup shape and the fenestration over the cup. This is for removing the products of conception from the uterine cavity. The basic mechanism is it captures the product of conception and removes them. So just showing you the same with the instrument. So you go with the instrument closed through the vagina and cervix into the uterine cavity and open and close and bring it out. And now you have the products of conception inside the cup, which can be sent for the histopathology. The last instrument is the uterine curette. It is a metallic instrument with two ends, one blunt and one sharp. The blunt end is required for the obstetric procedure and the sharp end is required for the gynae procedure. For holding this, you can hold it in a pen holding fashion or like this with thumb and the index finger and all the other fingers supporting from below. In both cases, the little and the ring finger will remain outside the perineum to act as a guard. Also, the role of index finger is very important as the part of the uterine curette that goes inside the uterus is predetermined by the UCL that you have measured. Our index finger should be at the measured UCL to prevent the perforation. Then gently in a symmetrical manner, curette all the walls of the uterus, interior, posterior, lateral. And towards the completion of the procedure, the uterine cavity starts to shrink. There will be grating sensation felt by the uterine curette and the bubbles will start to come. At the end of the procedure, the patient should have stable vitals and there should be no excessive abnormal bleeding. Thanks for watching the video. If you liked my video, please do like, subscribe and share the channel Love Obstetrics and Gynecology. Thank you.